The most important field in your Airtable tables is always the leftmost field. We call it the primary field, and it should follow very specific rules whenever you're putting together a new Airtable database. Are you following these rules already? Could you maybe use some tips on how to build better inside of Airtable? Well, it all starts with the primary field, and that is exactly what we're drilling into in this video. So if that's of interest, stick around and let's get into it. Welcome back to the channel. If this is your first time here, my name is Gareth and I'm the owner at Gap Consulting. It's our mission to help you to get organized and automated with no-code tools. Airtable is one of our favorite no-code tools. And in this video, we're going to be breaking down all there is to know about the primary field, that is the leftmost field inside of Airtable. I'm going to be giving you my pro tips, things that I've learned after having built hundreds of databases with our clients. But before we get into that, I want to first invite you to join me for our Airtable Crash Course. If you're new to Airtable or if you've been using it for a while and you know that there's more to it than you're fully utilizing, this crash course is going to get you on the path to 100% utilization. It's going to teach you about all the key features, all those things that you need to know, all the fancy things that Airtable can do. Grab that free crash course at gapconsulting.io/airtable-crash-course. Of course, we're going to include links around wherever you found this video, so check that out. But without further ado, let's hop on into the heart of things and get going with our primary field. Now, you can see right now in my database, I have three different tables, each table represented by a tab up here at the top. And each table represents a set of data. If you're new to databases, this kind of requires you to reframe your thinking a little bit. It looks like a spreadsheet, but it doesn't act like one. So make sure that when you create a new table in Airtable, it's very intentional and you're doing it because you have a new set of data. Doing this correctly is going to help you with your primary field. Again, the primary field is the leftmost field in every table. So here's my contacts, and I have my first and last name getting combined here for the full name. This is fairly common for a primary field. And so we see here that we've got John Smith with an email address. Of course, this is linked to some projects. But when we're talking about the primary field, we want to focus on that leftmost field. And there's a couple of reasons that it's super important. This is how this information is going to look as it gets linked through the other parts of your database. If you are unsure what I mean, let's flip into projects. Here in my projects, I don't have a name yet for my projects, but I do have project 1, project 2, and project 3 right here. And you'll notice that this is linked to John Smith. This part right here, this is a linked record. And what's showing up is the name that we assigned to the record thanks to the primary field. If I flip back into our contacts, John Smith is exactly how we had this showing up. But you'll also notice, back into projects, here's Jane. What is Jane? Do we know what that means? If we only know one Jane, then maybe this is helpful. But already you might start thinking, hey, this is not very descriptive. Just saying Jane doesn't really tell me who this person is. And you'll also notice here, I don't have any information because my third record in my contacts table, it never had a name assigned to it. And so we have absolutely no way of identifying who is connected to this project. So the key takeaway here is the primary field is going to be the way that you identify what is connected to your data. As contacts link over to projects, we are going to see that based on what the name or the leftmost field, the primary field, is showing. So it's really, really important that we get it right. Before we get into my rules about how to use it, I want to first caution you that it doesn't necessarily hold as much power as you might think. What I'm getting at here is that sometimes you might pick a way to identify your records with the primary field that is not 100% unique. If it's not 100% unique, sometimes you might link records to things that you think you're linking one way, but you're actually linking them to the wrong record. This can happen in the case where perhaps you have two John Smiths in your database. You look at the different options here, and if you have two John Smiths, well, then you have to be very careful and thoughtful about making sure to pick the right John Smith. Here you can actually see more information about each of the records. So here's John Smith, and we see john@example.com. Well, let's imagine, just for our example here, that we had a fourth person here, also named John Smith. And this John was Johnny at example.com. If we have such a record, when we are in our projects table, we need to be extra careful about picking the right John Smith from the list and making sure that we examine the information that lives here. Now, the reason that I really want to stress this is because if you are using automation in order to link or create new records and then connect them across your databases, it's very important that we don't use the name inside of our automation. And this comes to two simple reasons. Number one, it's possible to have the same name for different records. Here's John Smith, named right here. Here's another John Smith. If we are using the name of the record, it will break our automation potentially by linking to the wrong John Smith. Now, the other reason we don't want to do it is because if somebody were to make changes to that primary field in the future, and if we build an automation that relies on the name, well, if the name changes in the future, it's going to break our automations. Now, if you're brand new to Airtable, you might think, automations, that sounds complicated. I'm not doing that yet. But I want to caution you that at some point when you start leveraging the full power of this tool, well, you're going to definitely be using automations. So make sure to follow these rules from the beginning, and it will make things easier for you in the long run. So the key takeaway here is that we are not using the actual name of a record. That is to say, we're not using what shows up in the full name field or the primary field. We don't use that when we build automations. Now, if you're curious what you do use, every record has its own record ID. We can always call on this record ID with a quick formula. Just simply type record underscore ID, open close parenthesis. This is going to display the unique ID for each record. This is what we want to use whenever we're building an automation for Airtable, because it will ensure that we always get the right record. This is never duplicated. It's always unique. And it will ensure that if somebody changes that primary field in the future, it's not going to break our automation, because the record ID is what it is. As soon as a record comes into existence, it automatically gets a new record ID. All right, now that we have an understanding about how to use the primary field, how to not use it in automations and other things like that, let's keep doing a quick examination of our solution here. I've got my contacts, I've got my projects, and lastly, we have our tasks. Here I have linked up to projects, and right now that is blank, but you can see that we will be naming these projects as part of our exercise here. So I've got these different tasks associated. They're assigned to me, associated with a project. Right now they don't have names. So now I'm going to walk you through my three key rules for building any primary field. Again, that is going to be the leftmost field in any table in Airtable. Number one rule is going to be to make it as unique as possible. We want to make it unique so that it helps us not get confused with duplicate records under the same name. As you saw earlier in the case where I have two John Smiths, things can get a little complicated, a little confusing. So make sure that your primary field is as unique as possible. It does not have to be 100% unique, as I've already demonstrated. Flipping back over here, we have two John Smiths in this case. That's okay. We could make it incredibly unique, but we don't have to. My personal preference is to make it mostly unique, 97, 98% unique, and I accept it if I wind up having two John Smiths, like in this example. So that's number one rule, make it as unique as possible. The second rule is to make sure that it helps to identify what lives in that table, specifically in each record. So earlier I had mentioned that every table in Airtable represents a set of data. Well, this particular table is contacts. So in order to follow this rule to help it identify what lives here, you might say, well, Gareth, the email field is incredibly unique. I want that to be my primary field. The problem with that is it doesn't tell you much about the contact. Yeah, sure, an email is always unique, but it doesn't help us know who that contact is. I don't think of my contacts by their email address. I think of them by their first and last name. So with contacts, it kind of makes sense. Hey, listen, let's use something that tells us what this is. Now, the reason for that is, as you saw over here in projects, we're linking to contacts, and I want to be able to see at a glance, who is it linked to? If I just have something like Jane, that's not really helpful. It doesn't really identify this record for me. Dissimilarly, if I was linked to, let's say, John Smith, well, yes, I have two John Smiths in my database, but this helps me understand what is happening here. This is telling me who that contact is. Now, the third rule that I like to follow is kind of an add-on rule to the first two. Remember the first two. Make it as unique as possible and help it identify what lives in that record. Well, my third rule is to strongly rely on concatenate formulas. If you're new to Airtable or even to formula writing in general, concatenate is a way to string together multiple pieces of data. And by using concatenate, it's going to allow us to follow our primary two rules. It's going to allow us to keep things unique, and it's going to allow us to make sure that things are representative of what is being displayed. So let's take an example. I'm going to actually flip back into contacts. I don't love my contact name as it is right now, especially because I've got two John Smiths here, and I can't really tell them apart at a glance. So how can I make that better? I think of people, as I already talked about, by their first and last name, but I can add more information to that primary field to make it even better. So let's hop on in. I can say concatenate the first and the last name, just as I've done here, but then I can add something else. I can include a space and a little bit of a bar here to kind of separate things out, and I'm going to bring in the email address. So now I'm including the first name with a space, the last name with this symbol, kind of breaking it up, and then I'm going to follow up with the email address. Now when I save this, you'll see why I made these changes. Here, I'm now able to get a unique identifier for each record. Notice that it's not changing any of the data that lives in my table. It's just changing the way we display it and identify the record. So now I have two unique scenarios for John Smith because I have two unique email addresses. Now, one thing I don't like is the fact that here I have Tanya and I don't actually have Tanya's name in here. So there are different ways that you can make sure that you've always captured data inside of your database. For example, you can require fields to be filled out on forms and things of that nature. And if you notice that data is missing, as it is here, you can further fill it out. Now, that's not to say that there won't be instances where you wind up with some wonky looking records, as you do right here. Here I have not filled out any information. That's okay, because ultimately this serves as a warning to me that this record is incomplete and I should either find out the rest of the information or get rid of the contact and just delete the record entirely. Now let's flip into our projects and try to follow a similar setup. I've got my project name here, and maybe that's unique, but sometimes we might actually have another project by a same or similar name. Maybe someone on my team made a mistake and accidentally labeled a second project number two. This might happen, and I want to make things as unique as possible. Maybe this project two is going to Tanya. So now I've got project two for Jane, and we accidentally named another project, project two for Tanya. Well, a way to follow our simple rules, again, is to lean into our formula. Now we're going to build this concatenate formula from scratch, and I'm just going to bring in concatenate, and I'm going to include different pieces of information to rename this field. Project name is a good one, and I'll put another space, and then I will use contacts. So now I'm including what I've identified as the project name, but also linking that into the contacts. Note that every time I go to make a change here, this is going to tell me that there will be some field configurations that will impact some dependencies. So in this case, it's going to impact the way that we've linked to the contacts, projects, and the way that we've linked to the tasks from projects. So if you want to pause this, you can simply by clicking here. This will turn off the alerts that no longer warn you. But I'm going to confirm the change here, and this is now giving me a better layout of what I'm dealing with. So it's totally fine, totally normal for you to make changes to that primary field once you've established the different pieces of information that you want to include. Now I've got two project twos, but we know that one of them is for Jane, one of them is for Tanya, and that helps us to differentiate between the two when we're looking at this. If we want to make this a little cleaner, we can also include another bar in here to kind of break this up. And if you're curious about how to include a second line inside of your concatenate formula, well, first we'll want to elongate the row height, so we'll move it up to medium. And inside of here, rather than using this bar, I will simply say slash n. That's lowercase n, and save it. And this will now allow us to have that carriage return. So we've got project one, and then we see who the project is done on behalf of. Now, I'm sure you can figure out how I might include this for my third here. Now that I have filled out my project name, I can see clearly what this project is for, and so I can include this on this as well. Of course, I might name my task task one for a certain project, or task one assigned to a certain person, or task one with a certain due date. You get the idea. I'm including multiple pieces of information on that primary field to give me, number one, a uniqueness to every record, and number two, to allow me to see at a glance exactly what that record represents. Hey, I know we went kind of fast in this video. I hope I answered any questions you might have, but if I did not, be sure to drop them below and we will do our best to answer those. And in the meantime, keep on building.